the birds. The birds, they are chirping.
Look, I came all this way and I found you. Come on, say it for me. Say the words. Thank you. Appreciate that. I don't think you're the same kind of duck, but you are definitely a cousin. That's a long ass neck you got there. That other one's got its head in the hole. Saying hello to its little pal later.
Just like scrub all the tub trucks, but.
Yeah.
I bought it in haste.
Hello, chickies. Hi. My goodness. Yeah, so Marky has a couple like that, I think. She has one that kind of looks like this guy. I think his name is like Dwayne or something. Quack, 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 quack. Oh, oh, okay, all right, hey. Don't get mad at me. Sassy. Look, it's a hamster farm. That is one big guinea pig. Is that a guinea pig or a hamster? What is it? Yeah, what use do you have for guinea pigs on the farm? Look at that one back there with his little bug eyes. You see him?
Yeah,
under the lamp, he's like, actually, I think he's cross-eyed and bug-eyed. You poor thing.
Yeah, so they'll do the cooking demonstration in here, which is hard because you're cooking up something there where the temperature is much harder to control than you do these days. You set the dial, whereas this, your temperature is very reliant on the weather, the coal, the fuel. These are called scuttles, but they normally do up people, probably Welsh cakes or something that they're going to bake. But it gets our kids in to see how people, like Margie, because Margie would always be here at the stove when she came in. They had some little bits of furniture here, just to make it more like the cottage. But this is like the older part of the house. So we're looking at, you know, sort of 12th, 13th century, moving forward into the 16th and 1700s. But when this was original, there would have been no glass in those windows. This would have not opened to the elements in here. But yeah, your weather, how you light the fire, what type of coal you use, whether it's Cornish coal, Polish coal, Texan coal. One burns quicker than the other. So we used to light fires as kids. You'd always mix your coal for the Texan with the Polish, because the Polish was harder to light, but it burned for longer. The Texan was easier to light, but it burned quicker. So if you mix the two, you've got a good fire out of it. And it's normally funny to see them because they come and they set the fire here, and depending on the age of the person setting the fire, depending on whether it's going to light or not, you know, some of the volunteers come in here, they just pile it all in and hope in hell, never going to light. And then some of the other people get it going. But yeah, my grandfather had one of these, so I remember it. He used to sit there, he smoked, I think it was 60 coffin nails a day, the players. They didn't have any filters on them. That didn't kill them. Drank whiskey every day. That didn't kill them. These days, oh my God. And fried everything, grilled nothing. Everything was fried on the range. And then he'd pour what was left in the pan over his dinner for like juice or something. That didn't kill him either. These days, you know, cholesterol, Christ. But yeah, you do your drying here. Put all your clothes up there, or your germs, and dry it. And really good. When it gets fired up in here, it puts a bit of heat in here because stone buildings draw the heat out, stone floors. And unfortunately, now with the price of our energy, which has just gone up, 1st of April, we got a 54% increase in our energy bills. And it's going to go up again in October, another 45%. We can't afford to put our heating on now, so it's cold. It's cold in this country. If you're working away, you just sort of give up. Okay, we're not going to go out for a meal this month because our energy bill is not up. But if you're on a pension, state pension, lowest in Europe, state pension in this country is about £7,000 a year, which is not a lot to live on. you can't afford to put your heat on. So we actually now have people just watching TV in their sleeping bags. And then you have now an indoor coat and an outdoor coat. And whereas I grew up in Ireland, we didn't have central heating. And I remember getting up out of bed in the morning and the frost was on the inside of the glass. You could scribble your name in. But you always had a warm room to go into, you had the fire downstairs. Whereas now we don't have fireplaces because it's all smokeless. It's just central heating, that's it. And we're buying our gas from Russia, so here we are. But yeah, we need to go to a range by. There is an older party in there, a Mr. Drew would have just walked through here. Just come through that door, doffing his cap as he came through, body, little marigold sitting there with Lady Edith and Margie at the stall just there. And then he'd say, like, oh, you're here again, my lady. In other words, why? You're not supposed to be here. But that would take us to the scullery. It's a written scullery. It's really good, really old.
Yeah, they simply park at the village. All they do is just open it up with a wide angle lens, and this actually became the village of Downton. They had the village green here, so they set up the little stalls for the fair. The Crawley house, Isabel Crawley, the fair house is right there. But yeah, they put that there. We'll call it the memorial to the big disagreement we had back for a little period. But now we're all friends again, allegedly. But they had a little plaque on the wall over there for Archie Philpott. Because it was her nephew. He had deserted, but that was more to do with shell shock. Which we understand, of course, post-war. But they couldn't put him on the memorial, so they gave him his own little plaque. Archie Philpott was his name.
Mrs. Patmore's
nephew.
Nephew.
Yeah, that was actually Mrs. Patmore, Robert.
Yeah.
And that was the little plaque they put just on that wall right over there. But yeah, they just opened up the village. Of course, that's Highclere. That's what you're going to see. And trust me, when I know, I speak to Lady Carnarvon, and she can't tell me how many rooms she has. She said it's between 200 and 300. So, because I speak, so how many rooms are in there? Between 200 and 300. But they use the wide-angle lens. They just open the house up. So when you come down the oak staircase, you'll have to work on your photography skills because they don't allow photography inside the house. Now, that doesn't mean you're not going to take pictures. That means you're not going to get caught. Okay? It's an Irish thing. Rules are nothing more than a general suggestion. Okay? And if you want to get a good picture, just organize somebody to be a distraction. You know, and then everybody else takes their pictures. But that, of course, is Highclere. So we'll look a little bit smaller on the inside. They tend to use these two floors here. There's still a lot of work needs to be done upstairs, but thankfully you guys are still coming to Highclere. Well, that of course was the girls. That was the original, as I said, the eye candy. That was her awkward, frumpy stage, middle child. And of course, Lady Mary, that was always gonna be the heiress, always the pretty one. These two are hilarious, absolutely, in real life, absolutely hilarious. She's mad, she's like a proper rock chick. That enjoys music and drinking, and he just enjoys drinking. And they, when they get together, they're just like, the whole atmosphere changes, and they stay in the Carnarvon Arms, which is just outside Highclere. And the rule is, what goes on in the Carnarvon Arms stays in the Carnarvon Arms. But the actual bar manager was fond of telling people, oh, you won't believe what goes on, and of course they got rid of him. But she's really funny, and he's absolutely hilarious, absolutely. that was the jilting, of course, poor old Edith. But that was the best thing that happened to her. Anthony Stralin was quite, you know, just a fuddy-duddy, you know. Actually, the best thing that happened to Lady Mary was cousin Matthew getting killed. He was just too wet, too soppy, really, wasn't he? I like the other. She went through, she did do a try before you buy. But cousin Matthew, he spent the whole episode with the back of his hand stuck to his forehead. Oh, Mary, shall we kiss? Oh, I don't know. Should we just look at each other? Like, get on with it, you know. But then he couldn't commit to another series because Hollywood was chasing him. So he didn't commit to Julian. So Julian handed him his script. There you go.
Yeah,
so
that's
what, yeah, how'd that work out for him?
It's not worked out too well, has it? You know, I know Hollywood, it's a tough place, but he had really established himself here. And then, of course, he told Julian, well, I'll let you know if I'm around, you know, but my agent has me busy. So he said, yeah, no problem. You're dead. We can all see it coming. That was, we were back there at that cottage. That was Lady Sybil, her tomb, which they made, but never actually used in the filming.
Mm-hmm.
Just fiberglass. And that's what Lady Mary is like in real life. That's Michelle Dockery. That's Mosley and Baxter, of course. But yeah, she is brilliant in real life. And like one of her best friends, of course, is Branson in real life, which is why I always thought that they would have made a good couple to get married. The chemistry, the natural chemistry was there. There is some bad chemistry, but the good chemistry is her and Branson. And of course, that's Barrow, the moody guy, and all the girls. That was just literally just there on the green. Yeah, and that lady in there, Maggie, she allows the stars to use her house while they're filming. So he can go in there, Robert and all that, but not just the plebs. But if you want food or drink, down the end of the village, turn right, that's where they have the canteens all set up for filming and food. And I was talking to Maggie there one day, she had the gates open, and Branson comes down, and he said, Maggie, any chance for a cup of tea? And she said, oh, go on then, give me a minute. He was close behind, and he said, are you making tea, Maggie? Can you make it too? And she said, oh, you boys, you have me wrapped around your finger. And she turned to go in and make the tea. Robert Crawley comes down. Is that tea right here? Tea? And she stopped and she said, into the village, turn around. You know where it is. And he was like, okay, I'll go then if you're not making tea. And he went off down, she made them tea and biscuits. Yeah. And that's when I found out she's always the eyes. Don't you get it? Yeah, Robert, very funny. She always closes her eyes before she says anything and turns her head to the left. But that is them pretty much in real life. She normally has to get into character to be Mary. And then just before she goes into shot, he'll show her stuff on his phone. She'll get the hysterics and then has to go and try and be Mary again. But she actually got engaged to his best friend. That died before they got married. They got cancer and literally dead like that straight away. So another Irish guy from Cork, John Deneen. Gladys Denka. I love the relationship between her and Spratt. You remember Septimus Spratt?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I love that. That to me would have been a good little spin-off series. I found him hilarious. And the two of them together, they were absolutely brilliant. But that was the village itself. So looking just down there, mm-hmm. They just opened up the cottage hospital, Dopey Daisy, mates of course. And to this day I can't understand why Anna, even though they were married, never called him John. Like, morning John.
Morning Mr. Bates.
Anna, we're married, it's John.
Okay Mr. Bates.
And Daisy of course, and Andy. This is Crawley. And the doctor, of course, no real chemistry with them at all. He tells ridiculous jokes, guy jokes. She doesn't get it. She thinks he's an idiot. she says, Andy Wonder, his wife threw herself under a train. That's another story, but that is them just walking, literally, just coming up there. Just right, walking along there, just doing their little shot. The cars, anybody you see driving a car, It's actually their car. The owners drive their own cars. Again, of course, chatting away. We discussed the memorial to the great disagreement we had. Everything is good. A plaque. Oh, the two boys. They're brilliant. That's young Andy. And of course, Thomas Barrow. And we actually came here. They were filming. The church was all screened off. So we knew something was going in there. We could hear bagpipes playing in the background. But they wouldn't give us any information, wouldn't tell us anything. So we said, okay, we'll carry on down the village. And we ran across these two coming up from the canteen with their little sandwiches from the canteen right down the end of the village. And I said, we'll get some information off these guys. So I said, we'll keep it in character. So I said, Barrow. He said, yes, sir, cheese sandwich behind his back. Can you tell me exactly what's happening in the church today? So he said, all I can tell you is it's a very joyous occasion today. But Andy and I must attend to our duties. Andy, cheese sandwich, and off they went. And I thought, you sod, you're telling me absolutely nothing. But I think, oh God, what, dressed up here, so it's obviously a wedding. They're dressed for a wedding. Because they're dressed to attend the wedding, then we know it's a downstairs wedding, it's not an upstairs wedding. They're not serving, they're attending. With the bagpipes, I'm thinking Scottish connection. Mrs. Hughes marrying Carson. And I thought, oh, I don't want to think about that. I don't want them rolling around together. I want them paddling their toes and perhaps standing close to each other. Mrs. Hughes, Mr. Carson. It's only in the very last season that they called him Charlie, and hilarious. But they had that wedding in here. Let's see. Just a little car. Yeah, they took somebody's house. They just put a pub sign inside it, and then it becomes the Grantham Arms. or the dog and duck, which was down there. The woman's house down there, that was the post office. So they literally just go put a sign outside, and that's all. I was talking about the bad chemistry. Little Sarah Bunting didn't get on with him at all. That was the girlfriend for a while. The teacher did not get on. They just didn't like each other. And the golden rule, if you're going to talk about somebody behind their back, make sure they're not standing behind your back. She's quite sure. And he was chatting away about he had to go do a scene with the poison dwarf. And she heard it. So he was telling me that what happens when they're doing scenes together, she would be down the canteen, onion, garlic, anything she could get, stuff it in there in a sandwich, and then do the close-ups with him. And he said it was overpowering. Oh, that was Groucho. He was one of the extras, one of the dogs. And that was little Sibby with her older sister, Dopey Daisy. So she's always in trouble with Mrs. Patmore, of course. And we passed by that. As we passed by that before, we just put a little front on it, one little pub sign up, becomes the Red Lion, and that is Hannah just walking in. Bus has just pulled away, and she just went into the pub. So that's how we know where we are, between Ripon and Thirsk, which are real villages, real places, so we can pinpoint where it should be. And of course, as I said, that little birth certificate there this morning, that was the one that was ripped up by Margie's son.
The hills are alive with the sound.
I'm going to do it.